In this video, I'll be practicing my electronics hobby on my computer like it's 1993. Specifically, I'll be building a video frame grabber from plans out of an electronics hobby magazine. But first, some background on how the computer hobby and the electronics hobby goes back. Back in the dawn of personal computers, a common option was to just build a computer yourself. Computers were either sold pre-assembled or as kits you'd solder up yourself. Usually, the kits were a bit cheaper than pre-assembled. If you were especially adventurous, you could build a computer entirely from the numerous schematics published. By the start of the 80s, you probably wouldn't buy an unassembled kit for a computer you'd use for actual work, but some computers and add-ons could still be bought that way. Over the 80s, as computers got more widespread and useful, the schematics and modifications you could do to a computer would migrate over from computer magazines to hobby electronics magazines. In Sweden, the big one for hobby electronics was the localized version of the monthly-ish magazine Elektor. Elektor tended to focus on having a large number of projects of varying size and quality, with a small amount of theory in every issue. Aside from the monthly magazines, you could also get project compilation books like this one. Complete with artwork, ready to transfer to copperclad for those etching their own circuit boards at home. Even at this point, in 93, computers were simple and electrically forgiving enough that a happy amateur could build something for it. The parallel port was pretty much the de facto standard GPIO port on the PC, with the serial port also seeing a bit of that usage. But what I'm doing in this video is building what's on the cover of this magazine, a video frame grabber. This is issue 4 of 1993, and in it they have a design for a NISA card which can digitize pictures from a composite or RGB video signal. This is pretty cool to me. Not only does it plug into the actual expansion port on my actual computer like any other expansion I would buy, it also interfaces with the kind of video signals that I would find among my appliances at home. Sure, it's all old tech now, but at the time it would have been the tech you had around you. I plan to digitize some pictures from a VHS camcorder with this, which is one of the use cases suggested in the article. While the artwork required to produce the PCB yourself is provided, it is a double-sided layout which is a bit more difficult to make at home. You could either just buy the blank PCB from them, or you could get it as a kit with components. The components used are all pretty much standard, however, so you could have bought them pretty much anywhere you'd normally get electronic components from. In the early 90s, it was still pretty common for most larger cities to have an electronics parts store. But in Sweden, we also had a big one supplier, which also had a catalog and did mail order. 28,000 different items in the catalog, all of them normally stocked. So as a comparison, I'll flip through the catalog and figure out how much these components would have cost if I bought them from there instead of Elektor. Catalogs like this are quite amazing to flip through. They really have a bit of everything. As far as I can tell, the components would cost about 683 crowns, including VAT from Alpha. When buying the components as a kit from Elektor, it would be about 822, plus a 29% currency exchange adjustment, resulting in about 1,060 crowns. This seems a bit steep, but with a 10% subscriber discount, it might be worth it. For comparison, 1,000 crowns in mid-93 was about $128, which is about 280 in 2024 adjusted for inflation. But while we're here in the catalog, I'd like to point out another neat little feature. Any SKU with this diamond outline symbol here has more information available. If you called into their system and keyed in the SKU, the system would fax you the datasheet. Anyway, back to the build. This is a 31-year-old magazine, so it's not like I can just order that kit anymore. As the PCBs were a bit hard to come by, I used the schematics and artwork in the article to create my own modern reproduction. The components are all still available new pretty much, so that wasn't a problem. Assembling a circuit board like this is all pretty standard. It's all through-hole components as you'd expect. Start with the low stuff and work your way up to taller components. Aside from the bypass capacitors, there really isn't much on this board aside from the sockets. And finally, mashing the chips into the sockets. Yeah, I had to get the cheap nasty sockets for period accuracy. It's what they used in the article, I think. Just look at that. I'd say it's pretty close to what's on the cover. Now, if you bought this as a blank PCB from a magazine, you'd also get a floppy disk with some software on it. As far as I can tell, this disk hasn't been archived, so I don't have the software to use this card. However, I do have the schematics, and the article goes over the theory of operations, so I'm just gonna write my own software, with blackjack and hook. So, how does this thing even work? It's a fairly basic digitizer, designed to work on even the slowest of computers, like a PC or XT class machine, which seems like a silly system to grab true color images on, but okay. It can either capture a monochrome image from a composite video signal, or a color image from a 15 kHz RGB input. It also needs a separate sync input, but with a composite video signal you can just use a splitter. The card only has one analog to digital converter, so it digitizes one channel at a time. The video sync input feeds into a sync separator, generating horizontal and vertical sync pulses to drive the scan line counters for the sample data. The actual sample clock driving the horizontal pixel counters is free running and reset every horizontal sync. The resulting pixel samples are buffered into an 8 KB RAM. Yes, 8 KB, and no, that's not enough for a whole picture. You see, the analog to digital converter they selected is slow, and they clocked it even slower. So for every line of video, it only samples 10 pixels. So every frame, it samples 10 columns of pixels. Although, not all of those 10 columns would be in the visible area. Each scan line has a fairly large non-visible area. Once a frame has been sampled, you switch the board over into readout mode, read out the columns of pixels. Then, you set the register that offsets these 10 columns to the side a little and sample the next frame. This repeats again, and again, and again, until you've sampled the entire picture. A full resolution picture requires 64 frames to be sampled like this. And if it's RGB, then it's 64 times 3. A full true color image takes about 7 seconds to create. This means that the picture has to be quite still for you to get a good capture. So, I looked at the schematics, and this is my understanding of what registers look like in a capture device. First, it has these two readable registers, with the first one being the pixel data registers. Reading this will get the pixels out. And when you read that, you automatically advance the column counter. And then there's this second readable register, which is the status register with horizontal sync, vertical sync, status flags, and such things. And then there's these two writable registers. The first one selects which inputs on the card we're capturing from. And the second register, it has two modes depending on what the top bit is set to. So if it's 0, then these bits will either step the row counter or line counter down, and the second one will reset it to 0. And when it's 1, you're in capture mode, so you're actually capturing the signal into the buffer. And then this is your offset. So where changing this will move the column that it's capturing. Writing some code to interface with this shouldn't be too complicated. But I think this means I'm at the point where I'm going to have to install this thing in my computer, aren't I? Let's just hope nothing blows up.
Fire in the hole.
With a card in and no flames in sight, I started writing some code to see if I can see the card. Step 1 was to check the status register. With a valid sync input, I should be able to see the status flags changing. And once I was able to see that, I tried writing out the pixels on the screen. I used the same graphics library, Xlib, as I did in my game dev video. But when I seemed to catch the timing correctly, I couldn't get an image. Occasionally, I had static garbage that didn't seem to move regardless of the input signal. I started wondering if the RAM chip was bad or if it was too slow. But it turns out, I didn't wait for the next VSync, just any VSync at the end of the frame, which turned out to be the same one I started on, so I just turned on the sampling and immediately turned it off again. Which meant that I never gave the hardware a chance to sample anything. I also had a lot of trouble getting the board to work reliably, or at all. I started worrying that it was a bad chip somewhere. Especially worrying was when the system would stop posting or randomly crash. In the end, it seems like the ISO slots I had left were all filthy. With some isopropanol and reinserting a PCB 20 times or so, it seems to work a lot better. I now got the sampling working, but I still had no image, just a blank screen with a tiny bit of noise on it. I eventually figured out that there was something wrong with the relays not letting the signal in. So I added a bodge wire to bypass the relay. Honestly, I'm a bit underwhelmed. But I figured out why the relays didn't work. It's not one bit per relay like in my register map, it's actually a decoder. So instead of setting it to 8 hex, I should have set it to 3. But regarding the picture quality, or lack thereof rather, all is not lost. I'm currently trying to capture a monochrome signal from a source that includes a color signal. The color signal is a high frequency signal on top of the monochrome signal, which can cause a lot of noise and interference if not filtered. And this capture board does not filter the signal. But you know what? I don't want monochrome pictures anyway. I want to advertise color pictures. And for that, there's another component to this build. They talk about it in the article, and you can even see it in one of the pictures. This project is covered a few numbers later in the 7th issue of 93. It takes a compositor S-video signal and turns it into an RGB signal, and is basically the opposite of the digitizer board. The digitizer board was a dual-layer PCB, mostly digital in design, and used easy-to-source parts even for the time. This RGB converter thing, on the other hand, uses a single-layer board and is jam-packed with all this analog nonsense. Everything is powered by either 12 volts or some weird Zener diode arrangement. It also uses parts intended for TV sets. There's over 30 different values of resistors and over 20 different values of capacitors. So this is an unfortunate case where you could have made a PCB yourself, but the parts were a pain to source. Several parts have pretty much gone extinct too, like the adjustable inductors. The dual throw read relays were also basically impossible to find for a decent price. So I didn't exactly go all in on making this reproduction faithful. I found the chips at a surplus store, and pretty much all of them had date codes predating this magazine article.
So, there's a whole number of steps to how this thing works, but the reason for it is pretty simple. Television standard started out as monochrome, and color was added to it later when the world demanded color TV. To keep the signal backwards compatible, the color information had to be added in such a way that older equipment would just ignore it, which is why we can capture a monochrome signal on the capture board which doesn't know anything about color. But as a result, the color information isn't sent as RGB, but as a difference against the existing black and white signal. So for this board to operate, it needs S-video, and the difference between S-video and composite is that S-video splits out the brightness signal and the color signal into two separate wires, whereas in composite they are the same. And this design is able to split out the composite video into these two separate signals using a filter. So you will see here is the color side, and here is the like a white signal path. And here it has a filter, which removes the color signal. It's a chroma trap, so to say. This is a band stop filter that you tune to specifically the 4.43 MHz color carrier of HAL. And once it's tuned, it will eat the color signal, but it will leave the rest of the signal mostly intact. And this brightness signal then goes straight into this chip here, which is a color transient improvement chip. We'll get back to that later. And it also continues down here to this chip, which is a sync decoder. It is very similar to the sync separator we have on the digitizer board, except it also outputs something called a sandcastle pulse. And a sandcastle pulse is basically a sync pulse with three different voltage levels for signaling vertical sync, horizontal sync, and color burst. The color signal, meanwhile, enters this chip here, which is a PAL decoder, and it will take this one color signal in and it will split it out into two color signals, and these are expressed as red minus brightness and blue minus brightness. So they are relative to the black and white signal. And these two color signals then enter this chip, which is a solid state delay line. And this basically just delays the signal by 64 microseconds and then adds the delayed signal to the undelayed signal. And this is part of the phase compensation feature of PAL, which is what gives it the consistent colors, unlike NTSC. PAL stands for phase alternating line, and NTSC is never twice the same color, I think. These color signals then join the brightness signal up here in the color transient improvement chip. So when you get a video signal from a videotape or something, the color signal is usually quite blurry. It's bandwidth limited, so it doesn't change very fast. So this chip basically tries to identify these smeared out sharp edges and then reintroduce them. This causes it a bit of delay as it needs to know a fair bit about the signal before it can cause this transient. This is why the brightness signal also enters into this chip, because this has a little delay, about 800 nanoseconds, which allows the color signal and the brightness signal to stay in phase, so that the color and brightness doesn't misalign. And then these three signals, brightness and the two color signals, enter this chip. And this is what turns it into RGB. And this chip is actually intended to drive a CRT, the actual electron counts of a CRT. But with this output stage, it's able to drive a line-level RGB signal instead.
Building this is about the same as a digitizer, only that there are a lot more passive components and not many chips. A seemingly endless number of resistors and capacitors. Something about this board though, but you don't see much anymore, is the use of solder pins. It's these pins that poke up from the board. You use them with these sockets that you can solder a wire to. I also built a little enclosure for it. I don't like having powered PCBs hanging loose when I'm not at my electronics bench. Before I can use it, a few tweaks are needed. But most importantly, I need to adjust the chroma trap to minimize the interference the color signal causes. That looks better. To hook it up to the digitizer, I modified a SCART cable slightly and modified my program to sample each of the channels. At this point, I also looked into writing the sample data out into a picture file. I rummaged around on a SimTel share with CD-ROM that I showed a couple weeks back, and I found a specification for TIFF. With that, I was able to write a TIFF file writer. Looking at NES capture again, I'm starting to actually see some detail. Like, the text? It's backwards? Obviously. A bigger value written into the offset register would cause the first pulse to come earlier, as the counter is restarted on a higher number. So I reverse it, counting downwards, and it looks better, but it's still off. I think the video camera with the lens cap on shows the problem more clearly. It's like there's a weave of strips, where every other comes in the wrong order. Without understanding why, I flipped the top bit for the timing offset and now it looks... almost correct? It'll have to do. To show the general process, here's a capture of Super Mario on my NES. This is output into a TIFF file. From here, I need to do a bit of post-processing. In a magazine article, they used a shareware software called Graphic Workshop, so I'll do the same. First, I load up the file, and the first thing I want to do is a crop. There's a bunch of dead space in the capture I want to get rid of. After that, I do a scale. This is to get a more correct aspect ratio of the picture. Finally, I convert it into a 256 color image. It's a bit crunchy still, but if I can get pictures like that out of my camcorder, I'll probably be quite happy. With the general process in place, I get a fresh tape out of the wrapper and I'll just bounce around town trying to capture some stuff. And I'm back. I don't know how well that went, and it seems the camera has developed a habit of gnawing on the tape. The only difference here should be that I freeze frame something on the tape and then do a capture. So I go through the pictures one by one, and let's see how they turn out. Huh. There's something missing here, isn't there? Where'd all the colors go? I know it's December when I'm filming this, but it's not that dull and gray outside. It seems my RGB conversion box just doesn't like my camcorder, and I wasn't able to get a color signal into the digitizer board. I'm a bit disappointed that I wasn't able to get any nice color pictures out of this. It's been a cool learning experience, so I guess there's that. But if you wanted to just capture some stills from your camcorder, a video blaster wasn't that much more money, and it probably would have worked properly. I might mess around with this more off camera, but that's all for this video. Check back next week when I'll be installing Slackware Linux on my computer. Until then, thank you for watching.